All right, let's get started. Thanks to everyone who joined for CLF Austin's bi-monthly seminar series. This month, we are very lucky to have Marilyn Specht from Integral Group talking to us about embodied carbon at MEP systems and refrigerants. Just a brief introduction to our CLF Austin hub. We have three co-chairs, including myself, Martin Torres, and Dulce Trejo. And please send us any questions you may have or collaboration opportunities, or if you are coming from an outside invite to this webinar and want to join our local email list, you can email us at clfatx@gmail.com. We monitor that closely, so we will get back to you in a timely manner. The CLF Austin is part of the larger CLF national organization, which is an amazing resource of research and resources related to embodied carbon. And the national CLF operates through grassroots local hubs that focus on community issues, of which CLF Austin is a part. And some of the initiatives that both the national and local groups are working on are the SE 2050 challenge for embodied carbon and structural materials. The EC3 tool is something that the CLF works on quite closely, and others. The CLF also maintains a website, and a really great function there is discussion boards, opportunities to network and chat. So I put the link on the slide here, communitycarbonleadershipforum.org. You can sign up for an account there. It's free, and it will let you connect with local and national members of the CLF. And the CLF also has a number of community focus groups covering all the topics on screen here. The primary focus is embodied carbon, but we sort of take all comers on issues related to carbon and getting the word out about what we're working on. So with that, let's get started. So the presentation today is gonna be roughly 45 minutes, and we'll leave some time at the end for a Q&A. I'd ask that you leave your microphones muted until we get to the Q&A and hold your questions until then. You may also want to turn off your cameras to conserve bandwidth. Our speaker today is Marilyn Specht. She is principal at Integral Group and the US Sustainability Consulting Practice Lead. She specializes in creating the world's highest performing, most sustainable, innovative, and healthy buildings and communities. Marilyn's experience includes developing sustainability and wellness strategies and frameworks, net zero and net positive master plans, design standards and guidelines to create a healthier, more sustainable world. She is a lead AP, Bitwell Ambassador, Well AP, Eco Districts AP, and Living Future Ambassador. She served as the chair of the USGBC Lead Location and Planning Technical Advisory Group for 5 years, and currently volunteers on the Lead for Cities and Communities Working Group and on the CLF Atlanta chapter. That is a lot. And with that, I'm gonna turn it over to Marilyn so we can get started.
Thanks so much. Hi everyone. I'm excited to be here and talk with you all today. I'm just gonna share my screen, and sorry, you're getting a glimpse of my two babies, my four-legged and two-legged babies. That seems to be the quickest way to get the presentation up, but hopefully you can see it, and really thrilled to have the opportunity to speak with you today. I'll just go ahead and give you a sense of what I'm gonna talk about. I will just give a brief firm introduction, and I'll try to keep it minimal because I know that's not what you're excited to hear about. I'll probably roll through the definitions pretty quickly because I know if you're here, you're already passionate about embodied carbon, and I'm assuming you have a pretty basic, if not much more than that, knowledge of some of those definitions and the keywords that we use when we're talking about LCA and embodied carbon in particular. I'll get into a little bit more about embodied carbon and MEP and talk about some of the findings a lot of our research is showing. And then kind of as design professionals, as professionals in the building industry, you know, what are the steps that we can take day to day on our projects, working with our colleagues to really address and reduce embodied carbon as a whole across our projects while also considering MEP and refrigerants in general. And then as Greg said, we'll leave some time for Q&A and certainly always happy to have some offline conversations if anything else is coming up after the fact, but did at least want to call out, we just released our latest research white paper about radiant design and the whole life carbon study of radiant compared to typical building design. Our practice leader of our radiant design group out of the Bay Area is Noah Zalin, and he led this effort. It's a pretty technical report, and he's just an incredible mind and incredibly passionate. So I'd love to just plug that and share that as kind of the latest research of our LCA research that we're rolling out on a regular basis as a firm, and also open up the opportunity to connect you with Noah if you have any questions once you read that or want to dive into anything deeper. And perhaps he could be a speaker on a later session if there's some passion around that. So with that, I'll just dive in quickly to who we are as a firm. At Integral, we are deep green engineers and consultants. We were founded in 2008 by Kevin Hides, who is an engineer himself. And he really wanted to create a firm that's whole mission is around creating the most sustainable, highest performing buildings and communities in the world. We like to joke that we're engineers who want to engineer ourselves out of projects. We're focused around holistic, passive design, the integration of sustainability and health and wellness, and really a collaborative firm of really passionate, like-minded folks, not only engineers, but consultants. As Gregory mentioned, I lead our sustainability consulting practice for our US, which spans 9 offices in the US. We do have an Austin office that we're really thrilled about, doing some great work in Austin, both in the public and the private sector. And sustainability certainly continues to be more and more of a focus, as well as embodied carbon. But we do have offices all over the world, not only in North America, but in Australia and also the UK and Serbia. We had a Serbia office open a couple of years ago. And I mentioned we have MEP engineers, we have a big sustainability consulting practice, we do everything from energy modeling, design analytics, to planning and policy, working with cities and local governments on climate action plans, to commissioning and kind of everything in between. And our firm's mission really attracts folks who are passionate and really dedicated to fighting climate change and reducing the impact from buildings on the planet and improving the health of people who are occupying the buildings that we create. So no matter what office you're in or no matter what region, there's kind of that similarity across all of us. We really work across all sectors, public, private, aviation, science and tech, and really thinking about holistically the life cycle of a project, not just during design and construction, but also post-occupancy. And on my team especially, we really work across global portfolios, looking at sustainability strategy and program and benchmarking beyond just the work we do on the design and construction side. And I mentioned, you know, really integrating high performance, sustainability, and health is really our sweet spot and delivering that at scale in particular for large cities and communities. We've been involved with a number of cities and major organizations to develop science-based, evidence-led, just frameworks and responses to kind of the changing world that we're seeing. Certainly that brings a whole new meaning in the last year or two. And we really try to walk the walk as a firm. We were founding signatories to the World Green Building Council Net Zero Carbon Buildings Commitment. And we actually just achieved our 2030 goal 9 years ahead as of 2 weeks ago to be zero carbon. So we're all celebrating that. And a big part of what we do is working with clients to be transparent, and it only makes sense for us to do the same. So for the last 4 years, we've been rolling out our corporate social and environmental responsibility report, which is really our kind of reflection on how we're doing as a firm. And certainly a huge part of this continues to be the equity side and diversity, and having a lot of conversations about what that means for a firm in the building industry and what we can do differently. So that's been a big focus, particularly of late. And these are just some of our values and our pillars that we often come back to as part of our culture, and just really wanting to, in particular, accelerate sustainability across the building industry and really make a lasting change. So with that, I'll just dive into a couple of kind of grounding definitions to come back to and to help us move forward. You know, when we talk about building services and MEP design, not only are we talking about HVAC and plumbing, but we're also really accounting for lighting, any kind of security and safety systems, power supply, anything related to acoustics or escalators. So a lot of our studies, or all of our studies really, are addressing all aspects of MEP and our design and everything in between. And then of course, you all are, I'm sure, already know this, but when we're talking about carbon emissions, we mean greenhouse gas emissions. And so really thinking about CO2 equivalent. And of course, LCA is really looking at all of this and global warming potential throughout the life cycle of a building. So I'm just gonna skip through these a little bit because I know this audience. Of course, we'll be talking about embodied carbon. Certainly this addresses stage A, both in material extraction all the way through construction of materials. Some of stage B, which is kind of the use and the maintenance, repair and replacement of building materials, and then also the end of life. And as we go through, you'll certainly come to know that stage B in particular is a big part of embodied carbon when we talk about MEP, much more so than some of the other materials, such as structural, where the focus is a lot more A and C. Certainly, there's been a big focus on operational carbon the last few decades as we've gotten better and better about reducing operational carbon over the life cycle of the building. We recognize that that's only a very small portion of all of the life cycle stages of a project. So therefore, really understanding that whole life carbon comes into play when we're thinking about both operational and embodied carbon. And really all stages of a building life cycle and how critical all of that is. And I saw a statistic recently that over half of the carbon emissions will come from embodied carbon over the next few decades. So certainly, and I know we all feel that call to action of just continuing to think about embodied carbon, even if we have a net zero energy building. Of course, thinking about the bigger picture, we need to reduce our carbon emissions as soon as possible. This color scale actually represents the annual global temperatures from 1850 on the left to 2017. And IPCC recently reported that we need to reduce our carbon emissions by 80% within 9 years, 2030, to meet our 2 degrees C target. So, certainly urgent and certainly important, and lots of great work to do. So that moves us into MEP and embodied carbon. There's lots of conversations happening around structural materials and facades. And certainly that's all critical and important and a huge, huge opportunity to reduce impact when we think about embodied carbon. But if you think about it intuitively, you can expect the embodied carbon of MEP related equipment and systems really to be quite high as well, especially because of the maintenance involved over the life cycle of the building. And I'll get into that a little bit more around some of the assumptions we make. So it starts to become kind of a gap and a missing piece in a lot of projects when we're thinking about holistically total carbon of a project. So before kind of going into the numbers themselves and sharing our findings of some of our latest research, just kind of wanted to share that, you know, we're continuing to do a lot of great work on the operational side. We certainly have found a niche in zero carbon and zero energy design at Integral as a whole, and are continuing to kind of refine that. And I mentioned so much great work around structure materials and facade design, and even newer technologies coming out every year, interior finishes. We are also continuing to really hone this in on our work. But then as an engineering firm, a couple of years ago, we really realized the huge gap in the industry when we think about building systems. And so we kind of started to think about it in a very quantifiable engineering perspective, I would say, just trying to get a sense of how much impact, what are we talking about here? So just very rough takeoffs, thinking about the quantity of MEP systems in a building. It's kind of hard to grasp. It's not very visible. It's often hidden. It contains multiple components and materials. If anyone has done red list vetting or any kind of materials consulting, you know what a nightmare tracking down different components of MEP systems is. So we just kind of tried to put a rough order of magnitude on it. So you take, you know, a little over a 21,000 square foot building. Typically, there's about 25 tons of MEP related equipment within it, just on average. So just to give you an idea of scale, that's the typical weight of a fin wheel, which is pretty significant, but certainly not compared to a whole building. But when you think about that at a district scale or a city scale or even a global scale, even looking at, you know, New York City, for example, and the rough size of the city and assuming about a percentage of total land mass of buildings, it starts to really add up the impact and the size and amount of materials that we're talking about. The other aspect of this is that certainly what materials go into these products are made of mostly metals and plastics, steel, cast iron, aluminum, copper, pipework, of course, a lot of rare earth materials, and certainly some very intensive materials. Thinking about the impact of mining these materials, where they come from, what the extraction process is, what the manufacturing process is, what the transportation process is like, and what little is happening on the recycling side typically. A lot of times, you know, copper pipes are mined and produced mainly in Latin America, South America, and Asia. Similarly for steel and a lot of rare earth materials. So thinking about not only the carbon emissions and the intensity of just literally extracting and manufacturing, but then certainly the transportation across the globe is really significant. And, you know, when you think about recycling and processing that waste at the end of life, certainly other countries feel the burden of this, and some have solutions and some don't. And they typically end up affecting and being the responsibility of those with less resources and less financial support, and often in the global south. So there's just a lot of aspects of the whole life cycle of these materials that are really intensive, not only from a carbon perspective, but from a health and an equity perspective. And this diagram in particular just shows some images of materials and their equivalent embodied carbon. The pink is typical facade materials. And if you look at them comparatively to what's shown in the blue, the typical MEP materials, specifically metals, you'll notice that not only is the embodied carbon higher, but it's also based off of weight. So it gives you a sense of the intensity. So certainly aluminum is very, very high, which is, you know, typical that we see on the structural side as well. And I'll just also add, you know, if you haven't heard about or read the Design for Freedom report that came out at the beginning of this year, the end of last year, it's really, really incredible and really eye-opening for anyone in the building industry. It's all about social equity and social justice and removing slavery from the building materials that are commonly used across the construction industry. Steel is one it calls out, copper, zinc is a big one. So I would certainly recommend you checking that out, and I'm happy to share the link after this, but just another kind of, apologies, my cat is wanting to be part of the presentation if you hear some meowing in the background. But certainly part of the conversation of really looking holistically at the impact of the work that we're doing, not just from an environmental perspective, but also from health and equity. And thank you for sharing that. It's a great report, and can't recommend it high enough. So the other aspect of when we talk about embodied carbon with building services in particular, there's a really high replacement rate. If we're looking at a building over 50 years, 60 years, the amount of times that we're replacing electrical and HVAC equipment is significant, typically 10 to 15 years at best. So you see during that B stage in your LCA work, not only are you taking into account A and C stages and D stages, but B is much, much higher because of that replacement rate than other major aspects of buildings in particular. And so this just calls out some of our work just around particularly trying to fill that gap of research and understanding of MEP systems and equipment related to embodied carbon. I won't go into any of these, but I'm happy to share links if there's anything in particular that grabs your attention. I will say that our global LCA lead is based out of the EU. So some of our work with SIBC and also Letty is in London. SIBC is for UK. It's like ASHRAE in the UK. So we do have some work that's being done in different continents, but is certainly applicable really anywhere else. And the refrigerant best practice guide is a great one as well. So I'll go into a few of our key findings and just really trying to hone in on some of the take homes that a lot of this research has led us to conclude and also to start to address and really incorporate into our day-to-day work as engineers and consultants. Just because of time, I am only going to focus on kind of the commercial side. We do have some work that was done out of the UK that looks specifically at residential projects, and I'm happy to share that if that's applicable to anyone's work. But I work mostly in commercial, and that's what I'm most familiar with, and I just kind of made an assumption that that's what a lot of attendees probably do as well, but certainly a lot of the rules of thumb are applicable across the different sectors. So the first study I'm just going to mention is looking at just general kind of MEP embodied carbon accounting out of total embodied carbon impact of a building. We did the total carbon study a number of years ago. It was right around when I started at Integral back in 2016, 2015, I think, where we looked at DPR's San Francisco office, which is a historic building that they retrofitted and has been net zero energy certified through ILFI ever since then. and really compared it to a typical office building that was a new construction, and not only understood just in beyond MEP, but holistically embodied carbon saved for reusing an existing building as opposed to building a comparable building new, but also started to zero in on how much embodied carbon is coming from MEP systems in general. And we also looked at a couple of projects through the SIBSPI journal research that we did in the UK to better understand kind of a range of how much MEP typically accounts for of total embodied carbon. And we found on the low end, it's anywhere from around 15% to the high end of up to 50%. So that's certainly a big range, and I'll talk about some strategies that can be implemented to get it to the lower end, which is of course what we're shooting for. But just to call out that it's significant, 50% and even 23% is a big part of the total embodied carbon impact of a building. So that really led us to question, you know, where is a lot of this embodied carbon coming from? What are the biggest contributors? And where can we then start to zero in on opportunities to reduce within those larger chunks? So as far as, you know, total kind of breakdown, certainly a big chunk from HVAC and electrical and plumbing, all pretty similar, HVAC a little bit larger, but then of course a big chunk from refrigerant leak. And when we started to break that down even further, looking at the top right diagram from HVAC, in particular, it's huge related to refrigerant piping. Electrical is mainly contributed to lighting in particular. So certainly important to keep those in mind. And like I said, I'll get a little bit into some strategies that can be implemented to really zero in on that. And I believe this study was based off of a VRF system with air handling units. So certainly it is refrigerant intensive. This I will just quickly call out. This is from the Radiant Whole Life Carbon Study that I mentioned earlier. And like I said, I'm not going to go into huge detail about it, but I did just want to make, you know, these points. In that study, we did find that the embodied carbon impact associated with mechanical systems can actually be sometimes just as high as the impact of structure and facade, if decisions are not made thoughtfully early on in the design process. And certainly refrigerant leakage, again, can have a huge impact at almost a third of the embodied carbon study that report calls out. This is the refrigerant best practice guide that I mentioned. The idea is that it really is providing not only an introduction to the topic of refrigerants and why it's important, but really trying to gain as much industry awareness and educate around the environmental impact of refrigerant leakage in particular. And there's some really great guidance and best practices in there to limit the impact of HVAC refrigerant-based products in particular. So, and it does look at kind of different building level comparatively and a product level as well. So that's really helpful. So I'll just keep going through. This is another study that I believe was through the SIBSPI research that we did, MEP, that showed MEP can account for up to 80% of the total embodied carbon impact. I think that's a lot higher on that particular study than a lot of our other research showed, but certainly is not out of the question depending on the project and the location. But the good news is that we can reduce embodied carbon and MEP through good design choices, downsizing equipment, retaining and reusing more existing elements where we can, And certainly making sure to make right refrigerant choices is a big one. And then this just helps zero in again on kind of where the hotspots are and where we can take the most action. Certainly, got distracted by chat popping up. Certainly in this particular one, HVAC equipment is almost all of the embodied carbon. And making sure that certain design is accounted for correctly. This one in particular had chilled ceiling panels, and that was certainly extremely impactful in the overall LCA model and embodied carbon results. So I wanted to go through a few key takeaways, and it says for architects, but it's really, I think, for anyone that's involved in day-to-day projects. The big one, which is one that we really try to implement on our projects, regardless of embodied carbon, but just as good practice, passive design, thinking really about where we can minimize as many building services as needed. Just like if you're doing any kind of materials or embodied carbon analysis, wherever you can simplify the amount of materials, simplify the design, look at it holistically, the better you are able to take care of synergies and, thinking about air tightness and not just designing a building and then making sure MEP kind of makes up for anything that's lacking as far as performance, but really holistically approaching design in a thoughtful way. Certainly working with your partners on the engineering side to reduce overall MEP equipment. And of course, think about weight in general. Are there opportunities to reduce weight? And where are they? And how could that really benefit the overall LCA results and embodied carbon impact? And certainly thinking in particular, when we talk about MEP maintenance and replacement, how can we really make design decisions that are thinking thoughtfully about the full life of the project and how the building is going to be operated, which is easier said than done. If you're working on a speculative project and there's no tenants on board yet, it's you have to make some assumptions, but at least asking those questions, not only of your partners on the design side, but also manufacturers that you're considering, and really taking into consideration what's happening once equipment is done and where there are opportunities for recycling or take back or reuse programs. That's certainly not something that the manufacturing of MEP equipment has always been at the forefront. I think we have a lot to learn from our partners on the interior finishes side, though there's a whole set of additional circumstances and considerations with MEP equipment. But really thinking circularly about those opportunities and asking those questions up front is huge. Refrigerant leakage. All MEP products that use refrigerant leakage disclose the type of refrigerant used, and there are different leakage rates associated with them. So, start there. Start with low GWP refrigerants, reducing the overall charge, ensuring low leak rates, and making sure that refrigerant is always recovered, as much as you can. And then finally, just calculating, I'm sure you all know from your experience just working with embodied carbon and LCA calculations, you don't know what you're working with until you start tracking it. And by just tracking it, you often find you're saving carbon by just being knowledgeable and knowing what your options are and being able to drive those design decisions. So just taking that step to be transparent, to help inform the design when there's opportunities, can make a really big difference, and often is the key to really reducing embodied carbon, not only in MEP systems, but just in general with buildings as a whole. So I think that was my last slide. I have some slides hidden and I'm happy to come back to others. I know I went through that pretty quickly, but I did see a question that came up in the chat. So I wanted to make some time for that as well.
Thanks, Marilyn. That was great. So let's start with a question that came up in the chat. This question said, surprised to see concrete's embodied carbon content. All climate-related books bring up cement and steel as major carbon emitters.
Yeah, so I know we have some structural expertise on this, so I'll take a stab and then I'd be happy to open it up to Martine and others. But concrete is definitely one of the highest embodied carbon impact materials in the world. Steel is big, aluminum is big, but maybe I just misunderstood the question.
Yeah, I think that was in reference to the graph that was showing everything compared by kilogram. So like a kilogram of concrete versus a kilogram of aluminum, and you see aluminum's okay. A whole lot bigger. And so this is what, when you're comparing different building materials, and I'm going to speak to the structural materials part of it, not necessarily to MEP. But the important thing to consider is functional equivalence. So if I'm using however much concrete I use for a column or for a beam, I'm not going to use that same weight of steel or that same weight of wood or another structural material. It's going to be a different weight, but it's about establishing, okay, it's spanning the same thing. It has the same weight. So what is the functional equivalence there? So I think this is a useful graphic to kind of understand, like these manufacturing processes are different. But if you have a concrete building and you think about how much weight of concrete there is, and I mean, there might be some aluminum, but it pales in comparison. And not to say aluminum is not an important material to consider, but this doesn't tell the complete story.
It's a fair point, yeah. And I'd have to ask our team exactly where this graphic came from. There's no source, so I wonder if this is based off of our research in particular. But I hear that point. I think that's fair.
More question in chat. What, and I think that means HVAC equipment. Is it disassembled and metal recycled? What happens to the refrigerant?
It's a great question. It's particularly focused on residential, so I'm not as familiar with residential, but I would say it's probably similar across industries, though I'd welcome anyone who works heavily in the residential industry to jump in as well. I think in a perfect world, it is disassembled and recycled, but I think in reality, that's not usually what happens, but I think it depends on the manufacturer and the rate at which they're processing that. Different manufacturers, some of them have take back programs, and also depends on the region and the city you're in and what they'll accept as well.
Hey guys, this is Chris with the Indoor Weather Professionals. I just wanted to jump in on that question because we deal with that a lot. When it comes to the metal, it's so valuable that very often that gets recycled. The refrigerants, they're supposed to capture them all, but what, to be perfectly honest, what ends up happening is by the time we're going in to demo anything, a lot of times it's already been demoed. So if it's still in the system, and then there are companies that we can sell it to, and they scrub it and clean it up so that it doesn't have the environmental impact. But it's a pretty sloppy process overall.
Yeah.
One thing I would also add to that, just in general for architects and design, I gave this presentation to the AIA a couple of months ago about reducing the impact of refrigerants being leaked out of the environment. And my guidance to them was just to assume that it's going to leak out. And so what do you do about it at that point? And the answer is reduce the amount of refrigerant in the system. So for example, when you're really remotely locating your outdoor units, we often do that for aesthetics to kind of hide them, or we do it for noise. But you know, those really long line sets, we have to add so much refrigerant to the system just to get them to work properly. That when that stuff does leak out, the impact is huge. And keep in mind, it's like roughly 2,000 pounds of carbon. carbon equivalent.
Yeah. And thank you, Chris, for that. That's great. Great information on both points. And if anyone, I'm sure, as most people are familiar with Project Drawdown, you know, the number one thing that's listed that's going to have the biggest impact on climate change is refrigerant leakage and really controlling that. So it's a huge, huge impact.
Marilyn, for the chart that you showed, you showed a chart that was sort of comparing different greenhouse gases on a 100-year time scale. I was wondering if, given some of the refrigerants that have shorter atmospheric lifespans, there's some talk about using, rather than GWP 100, GWP 20. That sort of even further emphasizes their intensity as we look at like 2030 and 2050 goals. Have y'all looked at those different, or do you just use GWP 100?
Yeah, it depends on the study. For some of our project specific studies, we play around with that a little bit more. For a lot of our white papers, we try to take kind of usually 100, kind of a more industry typical approach. But even just playing around with, you know, life cycle of a building, we have some clients that say they want to have a 100-year building. And so we show them, you know, just from a maintenance perspective, when you're looking at B6 and B7, 100 years is great. There's a lot of embodied carbon saved, but then it opens up a whole nother can of worms of how often. And some of these clients are tech clients and they're completely redoing the interior of their buildings on a 5-year cycle. So I know that gets beyond a little bit about what you're talking about, but having those conversations really about operations and what is a nice to have versus a need to have, and thinking about that before building a space can make a huge difference in those overall calculations as well.
Great, thank you. So another question in the chat is about one of the graphics that you showed, Marilyn. It's in the slide with the donut chart with a breakdown of MEP into HVAC, plumbing, and electrical. They were unclear if refrigerant leakage was included in the HVAC slice, and how that affects the weighting.
Yeah, let me pull that up. Was it this one? I think so.
Yes.
Erica. okay, so I'm just looking at the, it's unclear the refrigerant leakage were included in the HVAC side. So over 50% or closer. So I believe it was, I see what the question is. So the refrigerant leakage is, I guess that's maybe, let's call it 20%, give or take, in the pink on the left-hand side. And then it on the right-hand side, that red, it looks like it's related to refrigerant piping. So it looks like it was excluded. Sorry about the confusion on there.
And we had a comment in the chat that I'll mention based on an earlier question, that undercharging a mechanical system can reduce its efficiency. So that's something to keep in mind.
It certainly goes hand in hand with just kind of weighing the pros and cons and thinking about, I feel like I keep saying holistically, but it's certainly true, you know, if we're going to save in one part but gain in others, you know, what's the difference and what overall for the whole life cycle is the better benefit. So that's a great additional consideration.
And then a part of this question was answered in the chat, I believe, but there's a second piece that maybe we could talk about. So the question was, what are the relative refrigerant charges by HVAC type, like VRF compared to central package units? Mm-hmm. And then I think this part is interesting. Are either of those types or other types more susceptible to refrigerant leakage? Are there leakage detection systems for HVAC equipment?
Mm.
A multi-part question.
These are great questions and I won't be able to answer all of them, but I'm happy to put you in touch with our lead mechanical engineer who will be able to. Yes, I understand there are relative refrigerant charges depending on the type and which refrigerant you're using. I don't know if some are more susceptible to leakage, but I don't know if Chris and anyone else who specializes in some of this. I'm not an engineer, so full disclosure, but I'm happy to get you in touch with someone who can really give you all the details and the nitty gritty of this. And I think there are some leakage detection systems for certain systems, but I'm not sure how standard that is.
I can address it a little bit. The package systems that you see have a lot less refrigerant in them because the refrigerant circuits are so small, they're all contained in the package. The other advantage they have is all the connections are done at factories under controlled conditions and they can be tested. So whenever you're not using package systems, you've got technicians in the field running refrigerant lines and T's and connecting everything. So you have much, much more human interaction. You have a lot longer line sets, a lot more places for nails to go through or screws from other trays. So package systems are by far at an advantage when it comes to leak. They usually do not leak until the very end of their life versus the other systems. On the leakage detection side, there is some stuff out there. It's very expensive.
Yeah.
With a lot of the new refrigerants that they're talking about going to, they're actually flammable. So I think that the leak detection is probably going to be included in those because of the safety.
Yeah. Thank you.
And then a couple more questions. Let's see. Marilyn, do you have any resources to share on minimizing refrigerant leakage from a building owner demolition perspective? So I think this is like, you know, the end of life best practices for refrigerant management.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so let me dig back through the refrigerant guide best practice. I do feel like there are some things in there that are called out, but I just can't remember exactly where it is in the document. So I'll follow up with you, Megan, on that and kind of point you in the right direction.
And also, if you have resources to share, we can also distribute that to all the attendees after the fact. Okay. So so everyone look for that as well.
Okay,
great. Let's see. There's a new question. Where are your MEP GWP values coming from? Are they peer review LCAs, EPDs? Are they commissioned or in-house studies?
Mm-hmm. Most of them are peer-reviewed LCAs, especially when we're collaborating with, you know, SIBC or LETI, which is through the City of London. A couple of them are in-house studies, but the total carbon study was peer-reviewed and a collaboration with a number of partners, including DPR and Siegel and Strain Architects. And a couple of others. So we tend to certainly focus on peer reviewed wherever we can. And we're big on collaboration. So Louise, who leads our global LCA department, is working a lot with EC3 and building out some of the data associated with MEP systems within that. We're also going to partner with ASHRAE to have some similar guidance that'll come out and hopefully in the next year to what we've been doing on the SIBC side in the UK. So wherever possible, we can get peer-reviewed and kind of cross-reviewed and cross-collaborated is really what we're trying to get to. And I believe the Radiant Whole Life Carbon Study was actually in a partnership with Clark Pacific. So that was also peer-reviewed.
Great, thank you.
So I know oftentimes the motivation for embodied carbon reduction or a big piece of how it's getting done is through a whole building lifecycle assessment. And I mean, seeing that range, what was it like 15 to 50%, definitely opened my eyes. But I'm curious in the context of an LCA, when people are doing this and you sort of get your material takeoff and you go through that whole process, who's doing that piece of it? Because I know as a structural engineer, I've done LCAs when I was with Walter P. Moore. Mm-hmm. But I don't have MEP information necessarily. So how does that get incorporated into the whole building lifecycle assessment process?
Yeah, so for a lot of our projects, our LCA consulting team, which is dedicated team that's focused on that, but also several of those members are also part of my larger sustainability team. So we will do that as part of a scope of service, just like we would for any kind of other sustainability consulting, and kind of manage really that whole LCA model. We're trying to work to getting all of our engineers globally trained up on best practices, and kind of good rules of thumb, which is certainly a larger effort. Some regions are more experienced than others. And the idea is that even if we didn't have consulting expertise on a particular job, that we would be bringing a lot of this knowledge base and just making smart design decisions, not necessarily calculating it, but could, but just as kind of a base mechanical design service. So it really depends on the project and the scope. Some clients really want to track all of this and understand what they're saving. And other clients, it's just not quite yet in their priority list. So I hope that answers your question. It really depends on the client and the project and the region in particular. You know, Vancouver and other cities around the world are starting to incorporate building codes around embodied carbon. So as we know, we typically see the biggest shift in the industry when there's either a requirement from a code or an ordinance perspective or some kind of incentive around it. So I'm hoping in the next few years, we'll start to see this become much more commonplace and less of a kind of specialized, unique aspect of the work we do.
And so now is the last chance for questions. You can type your question in the chat or feel free to unmute yourself and ask away. All right, not hearing anything. I'll give you back your last couple of minutes here. Thank you so much, Marilyn, for taking time out of your very busy schedule to present to us. This was excellent. And thanks to all the attendees and your great questions. We will be sending out an email with a link to the recording of the seminar, as well as any sort of follow-up resources for Marilyn and answers to the questions. So thanks, everyone. Thanks, Marilyn.
Yeah, thank you all. Great questions, and appreciate all the comments as well.
Thanks, Greg. Thanks, y'all.
Yep. Take care.